Hi, everyone. All right, time to wake up. How's, do we have slides? We do. Do I have a clicker? Yes. How many, there's a lot of people here. How many of you are going to make some kind of a startup after this event, when this is done? Could you raise your hand, please? Yeah. Wait, keep them up. Okay, one, two, three, four. How many of you are going to be one of those 15 startups every year that hits 100 million in revenue and deserves VC funding? More than 15. That's awesome. So this is a really good class. I made something which a lot of people don't understand is that these two companies that I have, Fog Creek Software and StackExchange, and I'm going to tell you that sort of just in chronological order to try to explain it. And there's all kinds of interesting lessons in there, I think, for different ways to create a startup and to bootstrap a startup or take funding. Almost every talk that I've heard today has assumed that you're going to be getting money from VCs. And there isn't enough money in all the VCs in California to fund all your companies. And so if you all kind of bang your heads against that door, some of them are going to get bloodied. I'm sorry, I'm really bad with metaphors. This is the very first Fog Creek office. Michael Pryor and I started Fog Creek Software in the year 2000. After we had been working together at a company called Juno Online Services, which was a free ISP. I never wanted to start a company. It wasn't, you know, my lifetime goal. I was already in my mid-30s by the time I started Fog Creek. And how old does that make me now? Point was that I couldn't find a cool place to work. I couldn't find a place where I wanted to work as a programmer. And I finally gave up on it and decided that if I was going to have a career that I found enjoyable as a programmer, I would have to build my own workplace. And of course, the irony is that I don't get to program anymore. But the very beginning of Fog Creek, we rented this office, and that was my desk. And I literally took home everything of the company in my knapsack at work at the end of the day for work. But I wanted to have a place to go to work, and it was me and Michael, and we hired a couple of people very quickly. Now, the reason we knew we could start a business, even though I'm kind of a scaredy cat and not an entrepreneurial type, was that I had seen a whole bunch of other businesses in those days. So this was the first dot-com boom, and this was sort of a period, much like today, when people were starting all kinds of idiotic businesses to sell grilled cheese sandwiches and whatever crazy, you know, Instagram for squirrels, except it was called something else in those days. And all these idiotic companies, what you could do is you could look at them and say, wow, if I did that company and I just didn't do these two stupid things, but I did them in a smart way, then that would definitely be a better business than this one, right? So for me, the model was a company called Ars Digita, which was a consulting company that Phil Greenspan created, which collapsed after they took VC. But everything did, really. We were going to make two tweaks on the Ars Digita model. So he had this model that was like, we're going to do open source software and then consulting based on the open source software. And my tweak was it was going to be proprietary software and consulting based on the proprietary software. And then you'd have another source of revenue, was the theory. We were both wrong. It doesn't really matter what my theory was. We worked on that for about 15 minutes before we effectively pivoted to something else. But the most important part of our business model is we weren't going to spend any money until we had some consulting revenue. And so this was a time in the late 90s when there was absolutely unlimited demand for anybody who could put together, you know, a less than and a greater than sign to make HTML on the keyboard, then you could bill about $200 an hour. And if you could actually make an HTML page, that was like double that. And there was sort of essentially infinite demand. There was a company called Cyent, which fortunately is now completely gone. But in those days, they hired thousands of computer science students and stuff like that to build web pages for people. And Cyent used to brag that they only accepted 10% of the clients that wanted to hire them. So if you wanted Cyent to build your website, you had to apply, and then you had to get approved by the Cyent board of whatever. So there was just way too much demand. And we thought, you know, we'll just take some of that overflow of all that demand, build some websites for some people, make a few $100 an hour, you know, with two or three of us, and build up enough money in the bank to basically bootstrap the business. And the truth is that worked for us. We had about 2 months of consulting, and I think we might have accumulated $250,000 in the bank or something like that. And that was really, really helpful. So we started in September 2000 in this very office. The consulting market, the dot-com crash occurred in November of 2000. I know the exact month because in that month, if you look at all these consulting companies, there was Cyent, Razorfish, Viant, March 1st, there was a whole bunch of them. And if you looked in November 2000, their billings went down by 90% in 1 month. And they didn't know it, because they thought that this was just an unusual lengthening of the sales cycle, meaning it was taking longer to close new deals. They didn't realize that this market had completely collapsed. And they didn't really decide that the consulting market was gone and never coming back until April of 2001. And in the meantime, they had these big armies of consultants, and they burned through every penny that they had in the bank, paying these armies of consultants to do nothing, because they had no clients. They had no clients because everybody got scared that the dot-com crash was going to happen and stopped hiring consultants to save money. Consulting market crashed. We had accumulated a little bit of money, and we luckily hadn't hired very many people. So we didn't waste all that money just keeping people employed when we had no money. We had hired a couple of people. We let them go. So it was just me and Michael for a long time as the co-founders. And we moved into this building, which conveniently my grandmother owned, and I was in charge of managing it. So I just sort of moved in and continued to pay her rent. For a while. This was our office downstairs. And we continued to sort of build a business really, really slowly. And because there was no consulting business, what we started selling was fog bugs, because it was the only thing we could find, which is a bug tracking software written internally in VBScript. And we started selling, you know, fog bugs version 1.0. And, you know, like the first day we sold it, there was like $2,000. Somebody bought a site license from Brazil or something. And it was awesome. And in fact, what we were noticing is, I think in the first few months, we were making somewhere around $5,000 a month, I think is the right number. And that was kind of enough to eat. And, you know, eventually we paid my grandmother for all the rent that we were consuming. As time elapsed, the neat thing was that this number was going up every single month. And it was going up very slowly, but it was going up. And it was in a really, really bad market. But we were selling software, and it just got better and better and better because we worked on it. And our revenue went up to, when it hit $15,000, we could afford to pay Michael a salary, and I had some savings in the bank. So $15,000 a month is, I always just automatically calculate $10,000 per person that needs a salary, and all our overhead expenses, including the rent, was $5,000. So we then hit $25,000, and I started taking a salary. And when we hit $35,000, we hired a third guy who came on to start, you know, answering the phones and doing some tech support and helping us with some of the coding tasks that we had. And at some point, we actually got an office. This was, I'm guessing, about 2003, so like several years on. It was a really long slog before we got our first legit office. And we built it out really nicely, and we were always obsessed about giving programmers Aeron chairs and 30-inch monitors and private offices with doors that close. And when we built this office, I think we had room, the first time we took this office, for 7 people. There were 7 desks. And eventually we doubled the space that we had there, and we made room for, I think, 12 people or something like that. And it was getting bigger and bigger. We all ate lunch together at this big table. These are a lot of summer interns. We took summer interns every summer, and that's how we did it, got our recruiting pipeline. And again, Fog Creek just continued to grow, and this is the last time I remember getting the company together for an all-company picture. But I think we're now at, let's say, 40, 45 people. So that's one kind of company, and that's Fog Creek. Fog Creek continued to do well. We continue to sort of try to launch new products every single year. We had this idea that bug tracking was not really the be-all and end-all of products, and we launched a bunch of stuff. We had a bunch of summer interns launch a remote desktop product called Copilot. That did pretty well. That actually, you know, more than paid for itself, and now earns us sort of a nice dividend. Fog Bugs was obviously the big breadwinner and is now a very large product. And we launched a bunch of other stuff. Some of it worked, some of it didn't work. We launched a job board for the Indian programmers market and made 50 rupees total, ever, selling one job listing. That was the worst product we ever did. And then I wanted to do this thing, I wanted to kill Experts Exchange, which you all probably know about, right? Does anybody know Stack Overflow? Anyone heard of that Stack Overflow thing? So the goal there was to kill Experts Exchange because they were evil. And what was cool about Stack Overflow is you could explain it that simply and everybody understood what you were talking about. You didn't have to go into any detail of how it would work. I couldn't find anybody internally that wanted to work on that, so I got together with Jeff Atwood, who's another blogger called known as Coding Horror, and said, you know, will you join us? This will be sort of a 50-50 Fog Creek Jeff Atwood joint production to do Stack Overflow. And I kind of thought of this as sort of a side bet, like, let's get Jeff working on this. I'll help him when I can. If this thing takes off, awesome. If it doesn't take off, doesn't really matter, but hopefully I can get rid of this Experts Exchange problem. But the Stack Overflow did really well, as it turns out. And the growth was incredible. Unlike the other speakers, I am perfectly happy to number the numbers on my y-axis. And I'll even tell you, the growth here was insane. From day one, we saw this, like literally every single week we had more visitors than the week before. At the beginning, I think it was, the numbers were crazy. We started out with like 30,000 daily visitors, and that's about the same number of people as I would get on a Joel on Software blog post. So I knew that was the Joel on Software audience coming initially. And over time, and that took 10 years to build that audience, by the way, writing a blog. You would look at the Google Analytics every single week, and it would just get a little bit higher. And of course, it went down on the weekends, and then it would just go a little bit higher. And at some point, it was growing by more than a Joel on Software like every week, and then it was growing by a Joel on Software every day. And it just grew faster and faster, and eventually encompassed the universe. At one point, when we were around 6 million on here, so this measure is global unique monthly visitors. That measures people that just visit your site once a month, and we place a cookie, and all we do is count the cookies on Google Analytics. So there's maybe two users on two different, maybe one person on two computers. The other thing about Google Analytics is that the cookie is placed on your domain, and we have four domains, so we have to break it down. And we may be double counting people that visit two of our sites if they go to two different domains, but I think that's okay, personally. And when we hit about 6 million users, we had a meeting with the folks in developer relations at Microsoft, and we said, "Hey, how many developers do you think there are in the world?" They said 6 million. They said 9 million. And we're like, okay, we got 2/3 of the developers in the world. And then we hit 9 million, and then we hit 10 million, and then we hit 20 million. Now we're at about 25 million of the world's 9 million software developers, depending on how you meet that number. So there's two kinds of businesses here that are completely different, actually. There are two ways you can build a business, and everybody up until now today, and from Zuck onward, has been talking about the get big fast business, and Stack Exchange is indeed a get big fast business. It's growing, the StackExchange.com domain is growing, and that's not going to work anymore, is it? The StackExchange.com domain is now growing at 350% year over year, which is, I don't know, not the fastest thing in the world, but it's pretty friggin' steady, as you saw from that chart, so that's how we... Sure. Thanks, Jessica. I wrote a blog post on Joel on Software a long time ago, like in the early 2000s, when I didn't have anything else to do because, you know, the economy was collapsing. And it was called Strategy Letter One, because I was very self-important and pompous then, unlike today, of course. Thank you. And I was writing about how there's two kinds of companies. There's get big fast companies like Amazon, and then there's organic growth companies. And I had just read the story of Ben and Jerry's, so they were an example of an ice cream company. And I kind of compared and contrasted these two different ways of growing a company. And what's interesting, of course, is that Stack Exchange and Fog Creek have kind of exactly the same characteristics. Stack Exchange is a get big fast company, and Fog Creek Software is an organic growth company. So first of all, how do you decide which kind of company you should be? It's not like you get to choose. Like, how many of you want to get big fast? Raise your hand, right? Okay. You have to look at the actual market that you're in. And there's two kinds of markets. A get big fast business is when you're in there for, there is some kind of a land grab. There is an attempt to capture uncaptured territory before anybody else does the same thing. Okay, so Uber is in that category. Amazon was certainly in that category. Ben & Jerry's was not, because Ben & Jerry's was just ice cream. You can't capture the entire ice cream market. There already is an ice cream market, right? This is like you're trying to, new technology is trying to land grab virgin territory. In an organic growth business, you already have a million competitors, and all you're doing is trying to claw them away one at a time, patiently, from your competitors. The reason you try to get big fast and you go for the land grab is because there are network effects. So you all know what network effects are? The idea of network effects is the more users you have, the more valuable your network is. And so a network of, let's say if Facebook had 10,000 users, that's not very valuable. And in fact, it would be extremely difficult. Facebook was a classic land grab because nobody's going to be on there if they can't communicate with their friends. It's the same reason I can't get anybody to use Kick, because there's nobody else on there. I mean, there's like 10 million people on there, but it doesn't really help. You know, that's not enough. I need a billion. And so a network effect says basically the value is increasing as you get more and more people on there because, you know, the value is a function of n squared, right? You're all computer scientists. The other thing about get big fast is that network effect creates lock-in, right? Nobody's going to leave Facebook for something that's 20% better or 50% better or even 100% better because their grandma is still looking for the pictures of the puppy. And she likes the pictures of the puppy that you upload. And if you stop putting them on Facebook, she's going to call you. Doesn't matter if the other thing is like more technologically innovative and cool. Now, in an organic growth company, you don't have these things. And so you don't really care about that, and you don't need to go for a land grab. And a land grab won't help you because you're not grabbing virgin territory. So that's what get big fast means. You need to be really big in order to create real value. And with organic growth, you're in there for the long haul. It took us 10 years to build FogBugs into a respectable business. And the reason is that there are a million bug trackers out there. And so with organic growth business, unless you have infinite money because you were born rich or something, you need to break even right away. You need to find a way to break even right away. And we did that by consulting, by essentially, you know, sort of whoring ourselves out for a couple of months to raise a little bit of cash. And you want to start getting money from clients on day one, and you want to start kind of obsessing about, I need to make this business survive so I can be there to slowly pry away customers, one dead customer at a time from my... and one thing about an organic growth business is you don't go in here unless you have a product that's valuable even with one customer. So the ideal business is something where the first person that downloads it and starts using it is already getting value out of this thing. You run your business completely differently. So when you're trying to get big fast, if you have a problem that can be solved with money, money is cheap, which I know sounds weird, but in this environment, if you have a successful get big fast business, it's very easy to raise money. There's lots of capitalists that are looking for places to put their money. And so you use that money to try to solve problems, even if it's a very expensive way of solving them. But in an organic growth company, you're trying to survive. You're just trying to stay around for as long as you possibly can. So you try to be frugal and cheap about everything that you do. Similarly, when you're trying to get big fast, you put up little signs all over the office that say move fast and break stuff. And the idea is to make lots of mistakes, and it doesn't matter. You got to be moving fast. You can't be scared in any way. You just got to be running down the hill. With an organic growth business, those mistakes can kill you. And when they kill you, you don't have any way to come back. The thing that scared us at Fog Creek all the time is that if we ran out of money in the bank, we would have to close. We did not have a source of $1 million to stick into the business to survive one more month. So you're much, much more careful in an organic growth business because you have to be, because this is your only business. And that means that the get big fast business, you have a tiny, teeny, weeny, very, very, very small chance of it becoming a $10 billion business. And I just made up the number 10 billion, but you know, really, really big business. And if you consider that, you know, of all the Y Combinator, let's say you all apply to Y Combinator and you all get in. I'm sure that's not in the cards. You know, two of you, actually, of all the people in this room that apply to Y Combinator and the 60, 70, 80, I don't know how I'm going to get in, you know, maybe two or three of them have a chance of being a $10 billion business. And that's being really, really optimistic. It's actually less than that. So your chances of making a $10 billion business this way by starting out trying to get big fast are vanishingly small, I'm afraid. And some people like those odds, so good for them. Some people, incidentally, all the people that make $10 billion couldn't care less. They're doing it because they're scratching an itch. They're trying to solve some problem that they have, and they're monomaniacally focused on that. It's never because they want to make $10 billion. Now, with an organic growth company, though, if you're just reasonably smart and you pay attention and you never make a terrible mistake, then you're going to make a nice $10 million business. And the number means $10 million means $10 million in revenue a year. And at some point, that's just going to be $1 million to operate it and $9 million that can go in your pocket if you own it. And you have a really good chance of being able to build that in 5 to 10 years in an organic growth business. It's just not that hard. There's a lot of businesses like that. When I used to write a column for Inc. magazine, and I always wanted to write something about VCs, and my editor always said, no entrepreneur takes money from VCs. It's such a narrow world of people that get investments from VCs. It's such a tiny sliver of entrepreneurship that if we write about that in our pages of our magazine, we get hate mail because nobody cares. It doesn't apply to their business. There's millions of businesses out there that are making somebody, you know, around $1 million. So again, those are the two models. Are you bootstrapping? Are you taking VC? And again, there are millions of organic growth companies, and there are a very, very small number of get big fast companies. I wrote a few hundred, but that's like the entire universe of companies, in the world. There's like one every decade or so from Silicon Valley. And not being able to decide is what's really going to kill you. So let me see if I can sort of finish a little bit of the story about Fog Creek and StackExchange. With StackExchange, again, we decided that it was a land grab type of business. And we spent a few years working on it, just everybody working from home and being frugal and all that kind of stuff, just to see where we could get. Now, one thing I don't know if anybody mentioned here, but if you are actually trying to raise money, you're always delaying as much as possible the actual raising of money, because as your company becomes more and more valuable over time, let's say your company now is worth $1 million, but next year it's going to be worth $10 million, if you sell shares, you're actually going to have to sell fewer shares to get the same amount of cash into your bank account. So at any given time, you always want to be raising the minimum amount of money you need to barely survive, as a general rule. And if you can delay the raising of money the very, very first time, then your life is much better, because you have to dilute less when you want to raise money. And it's easier to raise money when you have a nice story about how successful you've been on your own. So StackExchange was sort of technically bootstrapped for 2 years. It was called Stack Overflow then. And there were only 3 people working on it full time, and an awful lot of people from our community volunteering and helping out. But it was really 3 full-timers that were working mostly without pay from home. We built the servers, Jeff Atwood built the servers himself with his hands, and he optimized them to make them really, really fast. He put in a lot of RAM, and he got really good SSD drives and all that kind of stuff. We used a compiled language, which is unheard of, which actually allowed us to run this gigantic site on a very small number of web servers. It was remarkably small. I mean, for the longest time, we had like 3 boxes on the rack, and now we don't, but I think we could probably fit on 1 rack for StackExchange right now, which is a top 100 website in terms of traffic. So, we worked on trying to save money on the servers. We were reasonably frugal. People were working from home. There was no office. But we realized after a couple of years that this was a get big fast business. And I'll tell you why, if it's not obvious. With a question and answer website, there are very strong network effects. You go to the site where you're most likely to get an answer. And we dominate for programmers and pretty much anything related to programmers, including system administrators and SQL administrators and SQL query writers and all those things that are close to programmers. We dominate in math. We have 2 math sites, the research and the non-research. And we have about 90 categories where we don't quite dominate in most of them, meaning somewhere else there's another website out there that's a better place to get answers to your questions about whatever it may be. So a good example of that is Apple. We have apple.stackexchange.com. It's a pretty good site. I would guesstimate that it has maybe 20% of the market for questions and answers about Apple products. It's a much better site, but there is more traffic on Apple's own site and on other forums about Apple. So that's the land grab that we're trying to get, because none of those other sites yet have the magical upvote, downvote, badges, karma, reputation, all the comments, all the nice stuff that StackExchange has that makes it work as a Q&A platform. And it's not like people can't figure this out, and there's not a single person that builds a Q&A site anymore that doesn't have an upvote and a downvote button. That's not so hard to figure out. So that's the land grab, is we need to take all the traffic away. We know we can take traffic away from an old boring forum, because those suck, and it's a terrible place to get your questions answered. And what we have is 10 times better than that, and we can displace those. But if somebody else builds a StackExchange kind of work-alike with upvotes and downvotes in some category, let's say physical anthropology, that we don't have a site in, then they're going to take that market and they're going to have the network effects. So this is obviously a land grab, and we needed to move as fast as absolutely possible to capture as much as possible of this territory before it got divided up by other people. And that's why we raised money. But this time when we were raising money, it was like falling off a log. It was the easiest thing in the world. I only talked to VCs that I actually wanted to invest in the company. I didn't go knocking on every single door. I spent exactly 2 weeks on the fundraising, and then it was done. I mean, that's all it took. And I was able to raise from my number one choice of VC, which was Union Square Ventures. Like I say, it took about 2 weeks to put together the deal, and it was very, very easy. And that was because of, 10 years of work building Fog Creek and getting a reputation, and 2 years of work building StackExchange and getting all that momentum. So anything you can do to bootstrap, anything you can do to defer the moment where you need to go raise some money from somebody so that you're in a better position is going to make it so much easier to raise money under far better terms that's really, really worth doing. The other part of that story actually is I have 4 minutes left. Okay. The other part of that story is another product that Fog Creek started doing. Now I had to move over to StackExchange. StackExchange is now 75 employees, and we're building a 30,000 square foot office in Manhattan, which with a kitchen and everything, it's going to be fancy and expensive, and it's going to cost like $5 million to build out, but the landlord's paying some of that. So we're doing like these amazing big things at StackExchange. We have a lot of employees. We have an office in Denver. We have an office in London. We have, like I said, something, maybe let's say 50 million global users, if you allow me to double count some of them. and we're top 100 website. So that took a lot of work. I became CEO eventually of StackExchange, and that became a full-time job. And it turns out you can't be CEO of two companies at once because of the IP problem. If you invent something, it's both companies would claim to own it. So I only work for StackExchange, although I'm still on the board of Fog Creek, and I dip my toes in there every once in a while. And what they started working on at Fog Creek, by the way, is now, let's say, 45 employees, and it's a cash machine that just, because Fogbugs is like a minced money every month, and we're kind of like a kibbutz, and so at the end of the year in July, we take all the profit and divide it up among the employees based on seniority. So whatever money is left in the business at the end of the year goes to the employees, depending on how long they've been there. We don't dividend it out to shareholders. We just pay it in bonuses to the employees. So if you've been a Fog Creek employee for several years, you're probably doubling your salary on that profit share. So that's just a thing that mints cash, because we're not really, it's not that, we keep selling the product long after we've written it, although we are still working on that one. Recently, Fog Creek launched a new product called Trello. This launched about a year ago, and that's actually a get big fast land grab business as well. Trello is online kind of organization software, T-R-E-L-L-O. Go check it out. It's really awesome. And in the year since we launched, we went from zero to I think about 800,000 users, and it's doing great. It needs a dev team of about 10 people. We have to work on every stupid mobile platform under the sun, so we got somebody working on iPhone, and somebody working on Android, and somebody working on Windows Surface. And no, that was my idea, and the web app, and adding new features all the time. And we don't actually understand exactly how we're going to make money off of Trello. We're not quite sure about that, because we thought free was a really good price if we wanted to reduce friction so we could get big really, really fast and get all those wonderful network effects and have this massive land grab where Trello takes over the world of project management. And eventually, everybody here has said, we'll figure out some way to make money on that. In the meantime, I got 10 employees working on that and a rack full of servers that I got to add a new server to every couple of weeks. And that costs money. But we have this lovely cash cow of Fogbugs that's sort of spewing out extra money. So we asked the shareholders of Fog Creek, which is the employees, we said, hey, can we use your bonus that we would have paid you in profit share and just plow that back into Trello, and you're never going to see it again? And they said yes. And And we didn't have to go to a VC, and we didn't have to go to an outside VC. And by the time, if we ever get to the point where we just need a whole data center in Oregon somewhere in order to run Trello, which will happen, and we do need VC at that point, we're going in with traction, with an established team, with a product that's already proven itself, and you can take an investment on very, very good terms, even if you want to. And so at that point, I imagine you wouldn't give up any control of the company. Even now, I think if we raised money, we wouldn't give up any control. You'd probably still continue to have an absolute control of the board at that stage, and you wouldn't take very much dilution because the valuation would be so high, even though we don't actually make any money. So I'm sort of out of time, but this is the important part of what I've been trying to spew here at about a million words per minute. This is normally a two-hour speech. You have to decide if you're going to be a slow growth company or a get big fast company, because anytime you try to straddle those two lines, painful things happen to you. I'm traumatized, absolutely traumatized, because Juno Online Services, where I worked for years, was actually competing against AOL, and AOL was just going all out, sending everybody these damn floppy disks so that everybody would sign up for AOL, because it was a land grab. There was a land grab going on. And AOL had Instant Messenger, and Instant Messenger had network effects. And AOL had lock-in, because once you had your AOL email address, you never wanted to move to somewhere else, because you'd have to tell 400 people about your new email address. So AOL was building this remarkable land grab business with all kinds of network effects and lock-in and stuff like that. And Juno had every single one of those things, but was kind of growing in a more bootstrappy way because they were afraid to spend the money on the little stupid little floppy disks. And now Juno is a dial-up ISP, and I don't even know what AOL is anymore. But for a while, AOL was a lot bigger. So I was traumatized by that kind of failure to commit to one mode of bootstrapping or the other mode of getting really big fast. And I think you should decide what you want to do. You can really control your own destiny if you're willing to take a few more years and bootstrap with a small, kind of reliable business and use that to build your next stage, which is your Facebook, Netscape, Groupon for squirrels. Thank you very much.